Well, good afternoon. It's great to see so many of you here still smiling and looking happy. And it's nice to have you in this room in particular. We're delighted to host this symposium. This is a topic that's very near and dear to our hearts and a topic of utmost importance, but one that has actually not been examined very carefully. So I'm going to be hosting or managing the affair, and I want to start off by introducing the symposium. What are the issues we want to look at, and why are we doing this? So I probably don't need to introduce things this way, but many children in many communities are growing up in bilingual neighborhoods. Some of the issues that we're really dealing with are not just related to schooling. I guess that's what I really want to start off with, because many of the learners in our programs are children who are already somewhat bilingual or potentially bilingual before they come to school, and that's by virtue of living in communities that it themselves are bilingual, or they grow up in families that are bilingual or biracial or bicultural, whatever you want to call it. It's also the case that many children are interested in becoming bilingual, or at least their parents are interested in their becoming bilingual because of global issues. And I always, one of the interesting statistic in this regard is that while we all recognize that English is a global language, as this clipping shows, it's also the case that there are more second language speakers of English than there are native speakers of English. And I think this is a really interesting and important statistic, because it says that, yes, indeed, English is an important language to learn, but if you learn only English, you're probably not learning enough, because there are a lot of people, many people who know English and know other languages. So within the context of globalization, monolingual Anglophones have a certain advantage in comparison to a monolingual Serbo-Croatian speaker, but you're not going to have much of an advantage in comparison to all of those people out there, hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people who speak English in these other languages. So that, I think, adds value to what we're talking about. And of course, as we've heard at the opening plenary, increasingly parents are motivated to raise their children bilingually or to educate them bilingually because of the kinds of cognitive advantages we heard about at the opening plenary. And I don't need to go into that because you've all seen that in the newspapers and you all heard about it on Friday morning. Now, despite that, there are lots of concerns people have about either raising children bilingually or educating them bilingually. And I thought I would start off this presentation with this. This is a portion of an email that I received from a father about his child. And I'll let you just take a couple seconds to read that. And this was only part of his email. So I like this email because it's from a father. You rarely get fathers contacting you about their children. But I also liked it because as a researcher, this is my job. This is our job. Without these questions, we would have nothing to do. If we knew the answers to all these questions, we would, at least those of us who do research, would be out on the street. But for our teachers, you have to confront these questions from your parents all the time. So I think that this father is particularly astute in identifying all of the concerns you might have. But here's another excerpt from an email I got from a school psychologist, and I'll just let you read that one because it's a little bit closer to the topic of this symposium. So the issue here is that despite all of the advantages of children being raised being educated bilingually, there are these nagging concerns that people have, and even professionals have, about raising children or educating them bilingually. And that's really the topic of this symposium. So the question is, why is this really, and this sounds like a trivial question to ask, but I think it's worth laying this out in the way that I have. But the question is, why is this really important? This is not a lot of kids, and maybe they don't really need bilingualism and so on, but it seems to me there are some really serious issues underlying the suitability of the programs that we provide to all students. And one of them is a question of fairness. We've all agreed and we all know that these programs are the most effective way for educating children bilingually and giving them bilingual competence. And we also know that for local reasons, national reasons, and globalization reasons, there's advantages to being bilingual. So to deny these children the opportunity of becoming bilingual in our schools because we think that they might not benefit from these programs because they are developmentally or socially at risk is simply a matter of fairness. We can't in all conscience exclude these children from these programs and deny them those benefits without some justification, scientific justification. So in a related vein, there's also an ethical issue in my mind. And I suppose I'm coming at this from a context of growing up in or living in Montreal, but I think it's a similar issue for many communities in the US and around the world. If you're living in a community where two languages are functional within the daily life of the community, then it's important for children in those communities to learn those two languages. Now, many of them will learn languages of the community naturally, but it's often the case that linguistic groups are ghettoized, and they actually don't learn them at home or in the neighborhood. And it's school plays a very important role in giving them the opportunity to learn two languages, not because it's a nice choice that their parents want to make, but because it's a matter of long-term viability within those communities. So in my opinion, this is a serious ethical issue. Again, do we include these children in the program? And in particular, do we exclude them? And on what grounds do we exclude them? Because to exclude them from the programs raises the ethical dilemma that you're actually denying them access to opportunities to learn skills which are really important in their day-to-day lives in the future. Now, the flip side of this, I think, is also ethical, but it's also fundamentally pedagogical. And that is if we include at-risk children in dual language programs, then this raises a whole host of issues which are very, very, very complex. And I would suggest that in most cases we're not prepared to answer, but we have to in the name of fairness and behaving ethically. Questions like how to identify at-risk learners if they're bilingual or they're learning a second language. Are there some forms of bilingual or immersion education that are more suitable for some at-risk groups than for others? Early versus late programs, partial versus total. We don't know at the moment, and we should know. What do we do with students who are in the program and only get identified as having an impairment once they're in the program? Do we keep them in the program, or do we ask them to leave because we feel that they're not going to benefit from the program? If we invite them to stay in the program, or if they demand on staying in the program, then how do we provide them with the additional support services that they need and frankly are probably entitled to, because in many school districts, certainly in Canada, I'm sure this is true here, school districts are obliged to provide services for students who have special learning needs. Then what are the nature of those services that they really need? How do we meet their additional needs? And of course, there's the fundamental issue that if these children stay in the program, how do teachers work with them within the classroom, given their additional learning challenges? So there are really, I think, very deep and important and pervasive questions that arise around this issue of, is immersion suitable for all students? And we, of course, hope to give you answers to all these questions at the end of this afternoon. Not, but we certainly want to heighten awareness of what some of the options might be given the current state of our knowledge. So we have lined up four presentations that are going to describe research in three cases. I think Katera's is maybe not so research-based. And which actually address the issue of the suitability of not just bilingual education, but I want to broaden it to bilingualism for students who might be considered at risk for some kind of learning difficulties. And the order in which we'll follow this is I'm going to follow this introduction with my own presentation, which looks at dual language learning in preschoolers. And just a warning, this is actually not about children becoming bilingual in the context of schooling. It's really children becoming bilingual in outside schools, because I want to address the issue of children's capacity for dual language learning in a more natural context. And that will be followed by Kathryn Lindholm-Leary's presentation on developmental trajectories of at-risk Latino students in dual language programs, followed by Marjorie Myers, who's going to be describing research that she's done on special needs students in two-way programs. And finally, Tara Fortune is going to be proposing or suggesting some guidelines for supporting these students. Okay. This was a difficult symposium to actually organize in a sense because there's dramatically little research on these kinds of learners in the context of schooling. So what you're going to hear is, as far as I can tell, some of the only and best research on the topic. But one of the goals of this kind of a symposium, which I think should be held every year at this conference, is to check the health of research on these learners or what we know about them, because otherwise they're going to continue to be neglected. And any of you who may, at the end of this, we're going to have a discussion. We've tried to make room for lots of discussion. There will not be discussion at the end of each presentation. We're going to hold questions and discussion to the end. So if you have a question about specific presentations, please jot it down and then ask it at the end. But at the end, you may have some insights to give us because we don't. There may be things going on out there in districts, or you may be doing your own research, which would be useful for everybody in the room to hear about, because the research base otherwise is actually quite scant. Okay? So here we go. So I have to escape. Is that right? Escape. And then I go over here. And then there's me. Okay. And then I do F5. Wow. Okay, so I'm starting things off, and I'm going to do something that probably you weren't expecting, and maybe my other panelists weren't expecting. I decided what I would do is actually broaden our conversation by looking at research on children's capacity for dual language learning. In other words, and this is really looking at research on very young dual language learners who are infants and toddlers, from 0 to 3 and also 0 to 5. And my reason for doing that is that I think that this is very interesting research and probably many of you are not familiar with it, but it actually is useful for us as educators and professionals to know about because it actually provides a foundational knowledge which we can use in thinking about at-risk learners in school contexts. It may be a little bit too off track for you, but I hope you find it useful. It certainly is very interesting research. And so what I'm going to do is review research on children who are learning more than one language who are between 0 and 5 years of age. This is largely within home settings, not school settings. And I'm going to divide it up into two chunks, one that is looking at typically developing children. And you might wonder, well, what's this got to do with the theme of the symposium? And as I said earlier, to me, this research is really fundamentally important for all of us who work with dual language learners because it addresses the issue of whether there's something unnatural about having kids learn two languages. It really addresses the issue of whether the cognitive architecture of children's brains is designed to learn two languages as easily as children learn one. Now, I know that probably most of us in this room don't believe there's a problem, but we may encounter other people within our own schools, within our school districts, who are skeptical about what we do because they think that we're adding a burden to children's lives, and because in some cases we're talking about children who are at risk in various ways, we're adding an extra burden to children who are already challenged to learn language and to grow cognitively. So this is going to look at early preverbal and even preverbal and verbal development. And then I'm going to look at some research, very really interesting research, that has actually looked at young bilingual children who again are becoming bilingual within the context of outside school. And these are children who have developmental disorders and yet they're being raised bilingually. And what's interesting about these particular children, especially Down syndrome and specific language impairment, is they have a genetic disorder that predisposes them to have extraordinary difficulty learning language. So these children are a really interesting natural experiment to allow us to examine how far should we go with this bilingual thing. because if anybody should be kept away from bilingualism, it should be these children. Because they're having trouble learning one language for genetic reasons, then therefore many people think that they shouldn't be asked to learn two because it'll put them at greater risk. So I'll talk about some. There's actually more research on these kinds of children than dual language learners in school who are at risk. So that's my agenda. So I'm going to flip through some of this rather quickly. When should I finish? You know, just so I pace myself. 14 minutes, okay. Okay. So I want to, this is a section where I'm going to talk about language development in typically developing children, and these are very young children. So it's often thought by skeptics of dual language learning, and I know there's nobody like this in this room, but policymakers are often skeptical, and there's lots of naysayers. We've all sat down in the plane, and somebody says, "What do?" And you say, "Do I really tell him what I do?" Often I've lied, because I just don't want to get into that conversation, right? So this might help arm you for those kinds of conversations, although my experience has been that nothing you say to them is going to convince them. But anyway, there's a really amazing body of research now on children who are exposed to two languages prior to birth and at birth. And I want to just very quickly give you five sources of evidence that shows that it's just as easy for young infants to learn two languages as it is for infants to learn one. So this is not about what children do when they're confronted with dual language learning. It talks about what children can do with the right learning environment. So first of all, by and large, if you look at all of this evidence together, what you find is that typically developing children are born with the neurocognitive equipment that they need to learn more than one language. And the reason why we say that is that if you look at their developmental trajectory, during the first 3 or 4 years of life, you find that, I'll just go straight to this slide, that if you compare the major developmental milestones with respect to language acquisition, things like word segmentation, babbling, first words, all this kind of stuff that happens more or less at these ages, in monolingual children at these ages, these are very rough approximations, because as you know, there's huge individual variation even in monolingual children. But the startling thing is if you look at the same kind of data that's been collected on children who are raised with two languages from birth, you find that the milestones are the same. They start to babble at the more or less the same age as monolingual children in two languages. They start to produce their first words at about the same age as monolingual children, but they're doing it in two words, and so on. So what's interesting about this is that despite the fact that on average these children have half as much exposure as monolingual children, they actually go through these critical developmental milestones early on at the same pace and, of course, in the same order. It's also evident that that kind of research shows that the underlying neurocognitive strategies that children use to acquire two languages are pretty much the same as what monolingual children use to learn one. I mean, that's sort of an inference, but it's a logical one, that if you find that these children progress through the critical stages of language development early on at the same pace, that it's good evidence that they're probably using the same kind of strategies and neurocognitive systems for doing that. But critically, what's important is that these children are also different. So there's similarities, but there's critical differences. So bilingual children, in my interpretation, are showing certain kinds of flexibility in their language acquisition in order to deal with the extra demands of language learning. Now, I'll give you one interesting example, and then I'll move on to the next point. But these children, who are exposed to two languages actually use lip movements and lip shapes to identify which language you're using, or at least to differentiate between the two languages that they're hearing. They don't know it's French and English or Chinese and English, but they can tell that you're using a different configuration of lip movements when you're using one language versus another. You don't find this in monolingual children. Why? Because they don't need it. Bilingual children use these visual cues. They also use prosodic cues in the two languages to bootstrap into syntax because they need a way of differentiating the languages. So in these respects, these children are showing flexibility in the cognitive strategies that they use to separate the languages. And separating the languages is the beginning of learning the two languages. Now, at the same time, and it follows from what I just said, there's and you all know this, so I'm preaching to the choir, that there's no evidence at all that young bilingual children are confused by dual language input, even if the parents code mix themselves. So there's lots of evidence on this. This is really well accepted now within the research community. And from even with days of birth, bilingual children were monolingual, prefer to listen to the mother's voice within 5 to 7 days of birth because they're used to the prosodic pattern of the mother in the womb. So when they're born, the mother's language is familiar and they prefer familiarity at this age. Bilingual children don't show a preference to listening to both languages. They don't have a preference. They can differentiate the languages, but they don't prefer to listen to one or the other, which shows us that they've already started that first step in learning two languages. Another point that we have to consider, of course, is that when you're talking about children's competence, is that it's critical that we consider both languages. So the common case in point is the vocabulary development. We know, and this actually came up in Ellen's talk in an unfortunate way, in my opinion, but if you look at children's vocabulary development in one language, they often are behind monolingual children. But if you look at their combined vocabulary and give them credit for the labels they know for different concepts, they have the same or larger vocabularies than monolingual children. So their capacity to learn words for different concepts is not diminished by this dual language input that they get. But fundamentally, and this is some new data, the bilingual children are different from monolingual children. Okay, 10 minutes, good. And the differences that show up in this early stage of development are often due to the input, the learning environment in which these children find themselves. So you might find that these children are much further behind in the vocabulary development compared to monolingual children. You might find that they're mixing the grammatical structures of two languages. But if you look carefully, very often you can trace those deviations, if you like, in their language abilities to the input that they're getting. They may be getting not enough input to maintain vocabulary development on par with monolinguals. They may be using deviant grammatical structures because that's what they're hearing. Bilingual infants often hear input from non-native speakers. So one study published by Jean Parody showed that a Spanish-English bilingual child was producing many more overt subjects in her Spanish than is typical of monolingual Spanish-speaking children. And when they looked at the mother, who was a Spanish second language speaker of the language, the mother was using a lot of overt subjects in her Spanish because she was transferring, presumably, from English. So, and bilinguals use specific strategies to acquire the language, they're unique to bilingualism. So are you all familiar with the mutual exclusivity principle? Who is not? Okay, this is a notion that when children begin to acquire words, they tend to assign the meaning, new words get assigned new meanings. So if they hear a word that's new to them, they assume that it doesn't refer to something they already know. So new words that they hear are attributed to new things in the environment. And for monolinguals, this is a good strategy because it means you're not learning five words for glass, four of which are wrong. But bilingual kids actually violate the principle of mutual exclusivity, because that's what a bilingual is. For a bilingual, there are dual labels for everything. And interestingly, these children at a very young age show evidence that they're quite willing to accept two labels for the same object, whereas monolingual children seldom do that. So that makes them look different. Now, I want to show you some data, and this is a bit cheeky because it's really quite far removed from the topic, but I couldn't resist showing you this data. We've been working on children who are internationally adopted children from China who are being raised in French-speaking homes. And the data I'm going to show you is data from these children when they were 12 to 15 years of age. they were learning French as a second language, but they're, at this stage, they're monolingual French speakers. They've totally lost Chinese as far as we could tell. So we tested them in an fMRI scanner, doing a task where they listen to pseudo-French words, and they simply have to remember if they'd heard the word or not and how soon they had heard it before. It was called an NBAC task. It's a measure of what's called phonological working memory. This is a performance of, this is a brain cut through this way. This is the left hemisphere, this is the right hemisphere. The colored dots are the areas of the brain that were most activated in the monolingual children when they were performing this task. So this is the performance of native monolingual speakers of French. Okay? Now, I'm not going to give you the adoptee data right away, but we, as part of the study, we ran a group of children who were native Chinese speakers, who were born in Montreal, grew up in Montreal, and they started to learn French as a second language, because it's the dominant language, at the same time as the adoptees, which was between about 12 and 24 months of age. So these are very young second language learners. Right? So, but they're bilingual. They've retained Chinese, and they're now learning French as a second language. By the time we tested them, they're perfectly fluent in French and in Chinese. So what would you expect? On the basis of the critical period hypothesis, which generally argues that you can acquire a second language as well as a native speaker up to about 12 to 15 years of age, you would expect the bilinguals to look like these kids or not? Yes, you would, right? Because they're learning the second language before 12 years of age. Boy, okay. So this is what we actually found. Whoops. This is the performance of the bilingual speakers doing the French task. So their brain is engaging different areas of the brains to process French in comparison to the monolinguals. Now, this is striking when you think that these children started to learn French between 12 and 24 months of age. So in the brain, they're showing evidence that they're acquiring and processing French differently from monolinguals. And that's the message I want to end this section off with, is that even very young second language learners are different from monolinguals. And so as capable as they are of learning two languages to very high levels of competence, they're fundamentally different from monolinguals, and therefore we need to expect that there's going to be differences in what their language looks like. Anyway, I thought that you might find that interesting. The adoptees were exactly like the bilinguals. Anyway, so I want to switch gears very quickly, and I want to look at students, children who are actually at risk. And I'm going to talk about three groups of at-risk learners. Again, this is not learners in a school context, but just children who are growing up bilingually. And the three groups that there's research on, and the three groups that are interesting for our purposes, are children with specific language impairment, children with Down syndrome, and children with autism spectrum disorder. Children in the first two categories are particularly interesting because their impairment is specific, in the case of specific language impairment, to language. But children with Down syndrome also have great difficulty acquiring language compared to children who are not affected by Down syndrome. So the question that also often comes up is, does raising these children bilingually put them at greater risk of language learning difficulty because they have an underlying impairment to learn language, and therefore surely they will have trouble acquiring a second language. Children with autism spectrum disorder, it's not clear what the hypothesis would be, but these children have social difficulties and other kinds of cognitive challenges, which might lead you to believe that language learning is also challenging for them. But these children have also been looked at because they're really quite prevalent in the school population these days. So there's a number of studies. We just did a review of this research that's coming out in the Journal of Communication Disorders. The main author was a woman named Elizabeth K. Rainingbird, and we reviewed all of the research that looked at the language outcomes of children in these at-risk categories. And the critical comparison, which Ellen pointed to yesterday, was that we're comparing these at-risk kids who are being raised bilingually with similarly at-risk children who are being raised monolingually. okay? And the question is, does being raised bilingually put these children at greater risk than they would be if they were in a monolingual environment? Interestingly, all of the bilingual groups exhibited the same patterns of language results and the same patterns of difficulties as the monolingual children. So that's interesting in and of itself, because it suggests that despite the impairment, they're kind of approaching language learning in the same way as the monolinguals. That the bilingual feature does not make them really substantively different in terms of their learning trajectories and their learning mechanisms. She actually broke the data down by simultaneous bilinguals versus successive bilinguals. And very, very simply, what she found was that if you look at simultaneous bilinguals in all three of those risk groups, if you compare the bilinguals to the monolinguals in those risk groups, the bilinguals performed as well or better than the monolinguals on language tests in their dominant language. Okay? If you looked at the successive bilinguals, children who learned became bilingual by virtue of learning a second language after their first language had started, the bilinguals were the same as the monolinguals or better, with the exception that if you tested them in their non-dominant language, you would find that the bilinguals were performing less well than the monolinguals. Okay? So this is striking, because it says that these children's language acquisition propensities are so powerful that even though there's an impairment in that system, it doesn't stop them from becoming bilingual, and it doesn't stop them from becoming as bilingual as monolinguals. I'll just give you one details of one study, because I know I'm starting to run out of time. This was a study we did. These are bilingual children who were 8 years old at the time of the testing. They were raised in French and English, and they had been diagnosed as a specific language impairment. Does everybody know what SLI is? Should I define that? Who would like a definition? Okay, specific language impairment. These are children who are otherwise totally typical or normal. They're normal in terms of their general cognitive abilities, their general social-emotional development, their visual perceptual skills. They have no known frank neurological problems. They are different only in the sense they have exceptional difficulty learning language. And these difficulties are evident from very early in development, but they persist, so that even at 8 years of age, these children do very odd things. If they're learning English, they, for example, don't mark tense on the verb. So if they say he goes, they actually say he go. They don't use tense markers very much. So what we did, this is one of the first studies to look at these children. It's hard to do this research because if there's children like this who are being raised bilingually, the minute they're diagnosed as having a specific language impairment by a physician or a speech and language pathologist, parents often stop speaking both languages to them. So it's very hard to get these samples. But we compared them to two groups, a monolingual French group that also had specific language impairment, and a monolingual English group that had an impairment. And the reason we did that is because specific language impairment shows up in different ways in different languages. And you'll see why that's interesting. So the results were that the severity of the impairment in the bilingual kids was the same as the severity of the impairment in the monolingual children. So the fact that they were learning two languages instead of one did not put these at-risk learners at greater risk. And in a particular interest to us was that the patterns of impairment that the bilingual children exhibited was the same as the monolingual children. So the pattern that they showed in English was the English pattern, and the pattern they learned in French was the French pattern. Which is striking because it means that their brains are really dealing with these two languages as two languages. There was no bleed through in the difficulties they had. You might imagine, well, they're going to have difficulty. They're going to have the same difficulty with tense marking in both languages. That's not what they did. So it really, I think this is very powerful research because it speaks to how powerful this language acquisition system is that children have, that even when it's not firing on all fuses, it's still able to deal with two languages, and it's not at greater risk of not learning those languages than children are learning one. So I'm going to leave it there. And And there's a study on autism spectrum disorder. This will go up on the web if you're interested in this. So I just want to say that the general message is the evidence so far doesn't suggest that in the out-of-school environments, children, typically developing children or at-risk children, are at greater risk learning two languages in comparison to one. But these are group data. Children are different from one another, and you always have to make decisions on a group-by-group basis. And in particular, when it comes to schooling or raising children bilingually, just because children can learn two languages at home or in the school doesn't mean they should, because you have to start to consider other factors within the learning environment of the child to decide whether it's a smart move. So if the language environment doesn't support both languages, if the school system can't support both languages and the extra needs that these children have, if the parents aren't willing or can't provide additional support for these children, then you might want to think carefully about whether to embark on the bilingual route. But the evidence from this body of research suggests that other things being equal, these children can do it. It's not a problem for them. It's a challenge for the environment in which they live. So I want to end there. And as I say, it's not about the specific learners you're interested in, but I think it establishes an important base for understanding some of the other research that we're going to hear about. So the next speaker is Kathy Lindholm-Leary. And I'll just pull up her slide here. Okay. And if... And there's the point.
Well, thank you, Fred, very much for that introduction. I think that was a very helpful introduction to Bride. And I want to talk about the educational trajectories of at-risk Latino English learners in dual language programs. And I want to look at some of the background characteristics of these students, although I'm not going to spend a lot of time because we don't have a lot of time, and also the educational trajectories. I'm specifically looking at students who are currently fourth through eighth graders who entered school as English learners, mostly low income, and kids who are traditionally considered at risk, and also talk about implications. So the database consisted of 2,201 students, and as I mentioned, they're current fourth through eighth graders, and they're all Latino, native Spanish speakers, and they all started school identified as an English learner. They've attended the dual language program for at least the last 4 years for the eighth graders, and at least in second grade for some of the earlier students. Now I'm going to get into some data where we look at entry point, kindergarten, first grade, entry points, and of course if they entered at second or third grade, then that doesn't include those students. But most of these students have been in the program since kindergarten or first grade. We have about half of the students are male, about half are female. About half are currently in grades 4 through 5, and the other half are between 6 through 8. Most of the students, 89%, are very low income, and most had parents with a high school diploma or less. And I really want to focus on the or less, because a huge percentage of them had parents with considerably lower levels of education, and the California state data, and these schools were all in California, doesn't really look at, you know, it just says less than high school diploma. But when we look at some of these parents and we ask them about years of education, we have a large percentage of students who are 6 years or less of education. About 7% of these students were identified for special education, which is kind of similar to other populations of students who are identified for special education. In terms of program types, they are all students who were in a two-way program in both 90-10 and 50-50 programs. at one of 23 public schools or middle schools in 16 school districts. So it's data from a lot of different schools in a lot of different areas, some of them inner city, some of them suburban, some of them more rural. And I combined all of this data, and part of the reason is because when we start looking at early entry data and following these students longitudinally over time, you really need a large sample of data to really look at these students over time and really establish these trajectories. All students learn to read first in Spanish and second in English. So they're all what would be considered successive literacy students. In terms of measurement, in measuring English language proficiency of these students, all of the students were required to take the California English Language Development Test because they were identified as English learners in part on the basis of this test. And this test categorizes students into one of five proficiency groups: beginning, early intermediate, intermediate, early advanced, or advanced. And students are evaluated English proficient on the basis of their scores on the CELT and other criteria. And when they're considered English proficient on the basis of receiving a early advanced or advanced score in addition to other criteria, which vary depending on the school district, they may be reclassified fluent English proficient, or FEP. So what I did was I grouped students into one of the four English language proficiency categories for these analyses. I looked at students who were at what I call the beginning level, BEG, beginning or early intermediate, in their English proficiency on the basis of the CELT, which is 7% of the population, or 154 students. I look at the students who are concurrently intermediate, INT, 590 students, or 27%. Students who are advanced, that is, they're early advanced or advanced on the CELT, which is 23% of the students, or students who have been reclassified fluent English proficient. So that's 43% of the students, or 944. Okay, we also had other measures. We have reading achievement using the California Standards Test. We have Spanish reading achievement, which some districts use the Aprendo, which is a norm-referenced test. Some districts use the California Standards Test in Spanish. So I essentially group them into low, mid, or high in Spanish reading on the basis of their scores on those tests. We have entry levels of Spanish oral proficiency, and I grouped them in terms of whether they were low or high. Low means they were not proficient in Spanish, and remember, all of these students are native Spanish speakers when they entered school. We had scores either from the language assessment scales or the Stanford Foreign Language Oral Skills Observation Metrics, the FLOSM, depending on which was used by the schools at the time. And this is when the students were entering at kindergarten or first grade. And it would be beautiful if we all had, you know, if everybody used the same test, but they don't. So we're using what they had and trying to make sense of what they had when the students entered. So we have this entry oral Spanish data, and we've categorized the students as not proficient in Spanish or proficient, that is low or high. And finally, looking at the language proficiency bilingual oral proficiency at school entry, which is kindergarten or first grade. Now, if the students entered in kindergarten, but they also had first grade scores, we use kindergarten because we were more interested in what are their entry scores. So we have four groups, essentially: students who are low in both languages, students who are low in Spanish, moderate or high in English at entry, students who are low in English but moderate or high in Spanish, and students who are high in both languages. Okay, so there's four groups of bilingual oral proficiency at school entry. Okay, so if we look at this table and we look at students who are in each of the four different groups, students who are at the beginning, currently at grades four through eight, they're either at the beginning group, which we said were 7%, they're intermediate, they're advanced, or they're FEP. Okay, we've got those four groups. Now we're looking at those students and we're looking back in time at when they entered school, looking at whether they, at their level of Spanish proficiency, their level of English proficiency, and their bilingual proficiency when they entered school. So if we look at students who are at beginning, who are still kind of at beginning, early intermediate levels, and not surprisingly, this is, most of these students are special ed students. We see that the percentage of students that are have low Spanish proficiency among these groups is 64%. So most of these students who have the lower levels, who are at the early level still of English language proficiency, started school with low L1 proficiency. Not too surprisingly. But then if we look at students who are currently intermediate, at intermediate levels of proficiency in English, there about half of them were high proficient, half of them were low proficient in Spanish when they started school. If we look at the students who are advanced currently, as well as the students who are reclassified fluent English proficient, you'll see that about two-thirds or three-quarters of them started school with high proficiency. So it's not that students who have become highly proficient in English were dominant in English when they started, because you can see that they are stronger in Spanish, that they're strong in Spanish. If we look at their English proficiency when they started school, you can see that the students who are currently at the beginning levels were, three-quarters of them were at beginning levels when they started. So they haven't really made any progress over time in their English proficiency. You can see also that some of the students dropped their proficiency from a higher level of English proficiency over time. Among the students who are intermediate, most of the students started out as either beginning, early intermediate, or intermediate. If you look at the students who are currently at advanced levels, you'll see that they're kind of distributed about a third entered as beginning or early intermediate, a third as intermediate, and a third at early advanced or advanced levels. And if you look at the students who are FEP, it looks similar kind of to the students who are advanced, except that there's slightly more students who are early advanced or advanced. Okay, so this is kind of giving you a sense of there's differences when you look at these groupings of students now according to where they started, when they started school. So if you look at the percentage of students who are at different bilingual levels when they start school, I guess not surprisingly, among the beginning students, most of them were low in both languages. Among the students who were intermediate, 40% of them were low in both languages. And maybe, you know, when people talk about students staying at intermediate levels of proficiencies, it might be more likely because they're starting school as low in both languages. But then you look at the advanced and the RFEP students, and you can see that a larger percentage of these students come in higher in Spanish. They're either high in Spanish or they're high in both. Okay, but we have a lot of students who become highly proficient in English, even though they might have been low in English when they started. Okay, so the major findings, and I'm going to show the graph is even a little bit more interesting than talking about the findings, but when we look at kindergarten first and then third and fifth grades, what we see is that their entering bilingual oral proficiency. That is whether they were low-low, low-moderate, high-high. That entering level of bilingual oral proficiency has a significant main effect on their current level of English language proficiency at each of those grade levels. So that it's not just how proficient they are in English, which is what most of the research looks at. Their level of proficiency in English has an impact on English proficiency later on. But what I'm proposing is that it's not just English proficiency, it's level of English and Spanish proficiency that has an impact on current English proficiency. I also looked at the impact of Spanish reading achievement at grade 3 on English reading achievement at grades 3 and 5, and then at the impact of Spanish reading achievement at grade 5 on English reading at grades 5 and 6 through 8, and for each of the four English language proficiency groups. And what I found was that there was a significant main effect for language proficiency group and also for Spanish reading level, and no significant interactions. So I'm going to show that graph because I think it tells the story better than anything. So if we look at students who are, this is a graph showing the California standard total scale scores, and a score of 350 means that the students have reached proficient in English language arts reading. So if you look at the red solid line indicates students who are intermediate at intermediate levels are the red lines. The blue lines are students who are at early advanced or advanced in current English proficiency. And the green lines represent students who are fluent English proficient. And if you can see, kind of just looking at kind of the average for each of those red, blue, and green lines, you'll see that there's a significant effect for language proficiency group, which, you know, makes a lot of sense. Their level of English proficiency is highly associated with their English reading achievement. But I think even more important is the impact of Spanish literacy at each of the grade levels and for each of the language proficiency groups. You don't see the impact so much at third grade for Spanish reading achievement. But across the grade levels, what you see is that students with higher Spanish reading achievement do better than students with lower Spanish reading achievement. So for example, for students who are at intermediate levels of proficiency, you can see that they start out at third grade at about the same level. But over time, students who have mid levels of Spanish reading do much better than students who have low levels of Spanish reading. And we didn't have very many students who were at intermediate levels with high levels of Spanish reading, which is why you don't see it on this chart. Now, if you look at students who are at the advanced group, we do see all levels of Spanish reading from low to mid to high, although many fewer in the low group. And you can see if you look across the blue lines, the students who are low readers of Spanish do much worse than students who are mid readers of Spanish, who do somewhat worse than students with high levels of Spanish reading. And similarly, when you look at the students who are reclassified fluent English proficient, the students who are, again, we see the same three groups. If they have low levels of Spanish reading, they have much lower scores in English reading than students who have mid levels of Spanish reading. And the students who score the best and well above English monolinguals and English monolingual programs are the students who are high in Spanish and high in English. And those also tend to be the students who are the most biliterate, obviously, and the most bilingual. So to get to some conclusions and implications, what we see is that dual language education is associated with bilingualism and biliteracy, but at different levels. We see that higher Spanish and bilingual proficiency at school entry is associated with higher English proficiency at later grades. We see that students who enter school with low levels of English proficiency can achieve close to grade level in English reading achievement if they develop mid to high levels of Spanish reading, which I think is a really significant point. It really demonstrates the importance of students developing high levels of reading in the target language. So even among highly English proficient students, those students who are the reclassified fluent English proficient and advanced students, again, these are all former English learners, higher Spanish reading is associated with higher English reading. So these are not students who have given up their Spanish. The students who are doing the best are the students who came in with higher Spanish, have maintained their Spanish over time, have developed higher levels of English as well. And I think these findings all point to the importance of promoting really strong language and literacy in the L1 of English learners. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Marjorie Myers, and I'm the principal of Francis Scott Key Escuela Key in Arlington, Virginia. And I've been the principal there for 22 years. Getting to be time to leave. But it's been a wonderful and exciting experience for these last 22 years in this two-way school. And the year I began was the year it became a whole school program. So we've always had just immersion in the building, which has its advantages. Now I have no idea what to do about to get to the next one. Where are those? Okay. This year, of course, it predates me, but we're celebrating 30 years of two-way immersion in Key School. And we say in the county because it began with a first grade class at Key Elementary. And now we go all the way to high school. And we've opened a second immersion school so that between us, we serve 1,500 children a year. And it's a very small county. Arlington County is, you know, Arlington Cemetery, the Pentagon, and the airport, but only 35 total schools. I know there's smaller ones than that, but for where we live with Fairfax County, Montgomery County, there's some huge school districts. So what I do, I want to explain a little bit about the program, explain about inclusion at Key School, some of the findings from my dissertation, and some recent data. And again, what we're all trying to do is show whether dual language is appropriate for children with special needs. We try to have, well, we do have, as close as possible, a 50-50 program. 50% of the day is in English, 50% in Spanish, and the children 50-50. We count third language children as English speakers for some reason, just to keep the numbers right. So there are a few more Spanish speakers. Each day, the children have English language arts, social studies, and physical education in English, math, science, Spanish language arts, art, and music in Spanish. And I have a staff of about 80 to 88 teachers, and all but four of them speak both languages. I realized early on that it was like running two schools, my Spanish school and my English school, so I started to hire my English teachers who at least had a conversational level of Spanish so that it was more inclusive with the staff as well as with the students. These are just some numbers. I put it up for parents every year when we're going to do the kindergarten orientation. And the first year I did it in 98. I started at the school in 95. And the numbers have changed, but really not that much considering all the change in the county. And so for this year's numbers, we've gone from 544 students to where we have an enrollment. It's actually higher than that right this minute. It's about 725. So we've got trailers and all that fun stuff. The Hispanic children, 383, about 53%. The white children, 242, 34%. Black children, 39 of them, 5%. Asian children, 4%. Children that identify as others, 2%, and more than one ethnicity as 2%. Free and reduced lunch, we're about 42.5%. ESOL children, 30%. And then our special needs kids, which are the ones we're talking about today, about 11% of the children. And we're considered high mobility, mostly because of the folks that come in and work for the government and then leave. The numbers of actually transferring out to go to another school because of the program are relatively small, but it's more moving across the country. Just some faces of key kids, crazy. I had mentioned that there was this, you can start in elementary, and if you want, the county will allow folks to go to the middle school where it's a strand in the school, or go and then proceed to the high school, Wakefield High School, where they've got all the AP courses in Spanish for the students from Immersion, and where they can now graduate. This last year, they finally have a biliteracy seal on the diploma for high school, which is something we've fought for quite a while. And the nice thing is the children always feel like they're at home at Key School. Once a key kid, you're always a key kid. And they'll come back, always have some kind of party on our backyard when they're getting ready to graduate. And this is sometimes a reunion for the ones that have gone to the three other high schools. They all get together. They've done that for years. So one of the things when we speak about special ed is that it is a service, not a place. When I started at the school, I was told that we had four programs in the school. We had Immersion, we had special ed, we had ESOL, and we had Montessori. And that I was not to in any way mix those four programs. So that worked about a nanosecond. And by the next year, I had included the, unfortunately, the superintendent who told me that retired. So it was a little easier to defy what he had said. But I felt we had to include the children in the classrooms. So since the second year I was there, we've integrated the children with special needs and the English language learners in the classrooms with the Immersion kids. To me, they're the basis of who should be there, so it didn't make any sense that they shouldn't, but they were hand-picking, I guess, to begin the program for the first 10 years, children who were already bilingual to be the Spanish side of the Immersion, two-way Immersion. And that just didn't make sense to me. So I put the English language learners who knew no English in the classes with them. And I think that helped everybody. We do provide support for the native speakers, as language. We use native speakers as language models. We integrate the two. And we do have reading teachers. I've got 6 ESOL teachers. I've got 6 special ed teachers. So we do have the support that every public school would have. I just have to be a little more careful with how I hire my staff. Typical classrooms, whole group instruction, kids in centers. There are special needs kids in all of these pictures. The one on this side, it's a pull-out program with beginners using Orton-Gillingham. That's a classroom teacher with a small group with special ed in her classroom. In 86 to 96, no special ed students were allowed in the Immersion program. And mainly the last paragraph is, the hardest thing, again, is staff. I just hired so that a special ed teacher, maybe in a regular school, would work only with third grade. For us, they'll work with third and fourth. So one will do the Spanish side of the day, and the other would, so two of them, one does Spanish, one does English, and they split and do two grades. And that's our way of getting one per grade level so that there is support for the children if their IEPs say they need support. Since the math is in Spanish, the special ed teachers who support the children on the Spanish side primarily support with mathematics and also Spanish language arts. So right early on, I was invited to join GW to work on a doctorate, which I thought, hey, I've got that time for this. So it did take me longer than any known human being to finish this thing. And what was a question to me at the time was the achievement of the children identified with special needs in two-way Spanish immersion. So about 10 years later, I graduated. And they even gave me a big award for doing so. And then Tara bugged me to publish, so there's, I think it was the last edition of Bridge that was in paper. But what I looked at, not on very different from what Fred was talking about, was I took the children with special identified special needs at Key School and CIS as the Claremont Immersion School, which opened a few years later to take some of the strain off of us. And that's the one now both of us are up to 750 kids where we promised we'd never get above 500 in each one. The categories I looked at, because they were the ones most common in the two schools, were children with learning disabilities, mostly in reading, emotionally disturbed, developmentally delayed, and other health impaired. The other health impaired for us is children with ADHD, autism, sort of clumps everyone together. And the results for us, for me, were that if you see the red line, those are the children in immersion, and the green are the children in the, we call them the comparison group, but in the regular ed classes at the school, in the school system. So this is only looking at Arlington County. And then there were the four, I'm going to make the light. This one's going.
With the red button.
Oh, okay. Oh, sorry. So the our 400 is a passing score on the SOLs, which is the state test for Virginia. And the seven is the LD. Both groups, an average, hit about the same place. The next one, the eight, is the emotionally disturbed children, and our kids in immersion actually scored. Now it's not great amounts more. It's 460. The test goes from 400 to 600. Is passing. The tens were the other health impaired, and they were pretty close. And then developmentally delayed. And I decide we probably just baby our kids more or something. I don't know, but. Where there was a difference. Now, statistically and significantly, it's not that different, but what it did show us was it didn't harm the children to be in immersion. In fact, if anything, they did as well or better as the children in the monolingual schools in the county. And they were very careful in the study to pick very similar children. And I didn't know who they were, but if they were Hispanic children or Spanish-speaking children and they had LD, then they tried to find a comparable child in the English-only program. So that was matched very closely for us. And this has served me quite well when I talk to parents, and again, many parents want to pull their children out if they're identified with a disability once they've started school. But others do actually, I have this on the website so they can look at it, and some will stay with us despite the disabilities, and I think that's a plus for their children and also for us. And I think one of the important things is that the children, if they stay in the school, even if it's just through elementary school, at least they're leaving with two languages and not just English. So we do believe that two-way immersion does not give you the same results as English only. They read, speak, and write in two languages. And again, when they leave school, they have the two languages. So it's important to remember it's about the kids. We need to close the gap. And I truly, in my heart, after all these years, I know that this is the best thing we can do for children. And then before coming, I said, well, let me just look at what data is going on today. And this, you don't have to pay a lot of attention to it, but and also this is what we call adjusted scores. So they take out children who haven't been in the county for a year and whatever. So the average of all the kids at the school, we came in about 93% on the state test last year when we only need to have 70 or 75. So that makes the superintendent happy. The truth is, to me, this isn't realistic because you need to dig down into the numbers. Okay. So then digging down a little bit, if what I did was looked at the look at the math results for all the categories, all key children, all children at key, white children at key, Hispanic children, limited English proficient, the special needs kids, economically disadvantaged, and the gap group one, which is a combination of these groups. And, you know, we're only scored or accredited on math and English language arts. So there is a gap with the children with special needs, which I think has been consistent. And then social studies looks real good, but children don't have to take that one, so I don't count that one either. We take out the children. My teachers do that when I'm not looking. That was for key. And then the Claremont Immersion, very similar scores for them. We sort of switched places. We did a little bit stronger in math, and they did better in English language arts. Then I asked them to get me some other regular school so it would be closer to what we had done in my original dissertation. And so she looked at the number of Spanish speakers in the regular schools and got the ones that fell on either side of key school in the percent of Spanish speakers. This is like, ooh, punches. So the results of the children with special needs on the math test, key school was 55%, Claremont was 42%. And then the other schools that sort of wrap around us in terms of numbers weren't that far off. And those are English-only schools in the math. The one, number five, seems to be doing pretty well across the board. Let's figure out what she's doing. And in English language arts, same thing. Key school at 48%, Claremont at 53%. These are just the children with special needs. And then the other schools, 62, 59, 48, and 48. So again, the scores are not that far off between, and there was no work to put that together. I should have done that the first time. But it is nice to just get a quick picture where we are today versus when I finished the dissertation in 2009. So I do feel that children with language and learning disabilities perform as well and are comparable to children in English-only programs, and that they have the ability, they can benefit for the program no matter what their abilities are. And I remember years ago we had a little girl who was a Down syndrome child, and by the time she left the school, which broke my heart, she should have just stayed there because it fell apart afterwards, but she only got to two-word sort of ability to pronounce, to speak two words, sentences or phrases, and yet she could understand us in both English and Spanish. And her parents spoke no English at all. So to me, even at that level, she still left the program and had two languages, even if it was a very low level. For me, students at risk need a strong academic program for support, and that we need to not take no for an answer for children with special needs. Personally, I think every school in the country should be an immersion school. And what we're waiting around for, I'll never know. And we know that they should stay in the two-way immersion programs and succeed in them, and that they benefit from an enriched education program. So they need to be part of it, because what can also happen is they're in the building, but they're not in the classes. So keeping the teachers with me on keeping the children in the class and benefiting from their peers and from the language-rich environment is difficult, because it's very easy to get pulled out all the time and not be part of the classroom, even though they're in the building. And I just feel we need to level the playing field for all children.
And one of the things I always say to parents is today, when you can buy anything from anywhere and get it in minutes, the only thing you can't buy is bilingualism. And that's the greatest gift you can give your children. Okay, and if you're ever in Arlington, Virginia, come visit. Thank you very much.
So I'm delighted to be here participating in this, this research symposium. What I was asked to do, because I'm not currently doing research in the area of special needs learner, my current work is in Mandarin immersion education. We have a study we've just collected data on, actually we're excited about, because we'll be looking at the reading strategies of grade 4 Mandarin immersion students, and we're looking both at low and high skilled readers to see if there's any differences so we can learn what kinds of reading strategies are these fourth graders using when they're reading in text in Mandarin and when they're reading text in English. We're hoping to be able to find some interesting things for the Mandarin immersion context. But what I was asked to do today was actually to do a research-based update on what do we know about intervention and what might be some guideposts we could establish for bilingual intervention. One of my ahas as I was working on this was I've always talked about intervention practices, but I'm changing my language. I'm going to talk about the importance of bilingual intervention for our immersion and dual language programs. I think that's kind of an important takeaway, shift in language and thinking. I want to call your attention to, just so you know, what were the studies that I took a look at while I was preparing this brief presentation. What did I synthesize? And you have these studies here in case you would like to go and look any of them up. These two publications, the National Reading Panel Teaching Children to Read report, came out in 2000, as I'm sure you are aware, and it really made quite the splash in terms of providing a synthesis of research-based information on what is needed when it comes to teaching children to read. One of the big takeaways from that publication was the five big ideas in beginning reading. This pertains especially to alphabetic languages. And they are, you could probably recite them with me, those of you in elementary education, phonemic awareness, alphabetic principle, fluency, vocabulary, and you got it. One of the things that was true about this first publication was that what it did not include was a look at second language learners. So there was another reading panel pulled together, of which our esteemed Fred Genesee was actually invited to be a part of. And they published in 2006, Developing Literacy in Second Language Learners. In 2009, there was a review article published of this 2006 book. It was written by the co-editors, Diane August, Tim Shanahan, and Kathy Escamilla. And what they did first off was call attention to the very small number of studies that addressed how to best offer reading intervention to English learners with special needs. No studies were included in the 2006 publication that looked at English home language students with special needs who were participating in immersion programs. The review was also limited to studies that were published before 2004. What the review did find, there were a couple of takeaways. One, that it did find that those reviewed interventions tended to produce smaller effect sizes. So interventions that had been effective for English home language kids tended to be a little less effective for English learners, smaller effect sizes. They also found that modifications to the interventions that were being used for English-speaking children learning to read, those that were initially designed for them, it was necessary for them to be modified in order for them to be relevant and beneficial for English learners. Okay, so you couldn't just take the interventions as is. They needed to be modified in order to make them more relevant. In this review of the 2006 book, they also pointed out the paucity of studies, which is what Fred alluded to earlier. One of the consistent themes is we really don't know nearly as much in terms of high-quality research-based evidence as we would like to when it comes to special needs children who are also English learners. Only a small number of studies, 12, were reviewed, and these involved only a few subjects. And 8 of the studies, fewer than 5 students. So you can see that it's very difficult to make any robust conclusions with these based on this kind of data. Since 2006, there have been a few additional studies looking at language and literacy development of English learners, and most of these were carried out with Spanish home language children being taught in English medium classrooms, so really not our immersion and dual language context, mostly English medium classrooms with some first language support. This suggests to me that they were much more likely maybe transitional bilingual programs or even not quite transitional bilingual. The meta-analysis with the largest number of participants, which is this first one here, right? I'm sorry, I'm having trouble. Tracking. The meta-analysis with the largest number did not look at English learners with language impairment or with reading difficulties. So that's just looking at English learners. Whereas these two meta-analyses here did. Now, the point of sharing this information in this slide is, again, to call attention to the fact that overall there's a dearth of research-based information on how to go about providing interventions to immersion and dual language children, especially those who exhibit reading difficulties. That said, we do have a number of general research-based guidelines that have been established over decades for intervention practices for struggling readers. And these include recommendations such as offering sustained and intensive interventions, employing explicit and direct instruction. By sustained and intensive, let me just mention that we're talking for the K-3 range, like 20 weeks of daily sessions, or for grades 4-8, one semester of daily sessions, okay? So that's the description of what we're talking about with sustained and intensive. One of the other clear guidelines from the research is start early. The wait and see, and if there's probably the biggest message, I think the biggest change in the last decade is the importance of not simply using the wait and see approach, right? Let's just wait and see how they do. After all, they're learning through a second language. We don't really need to act until grade 2 or grade 3 when we can formally assess them, et cetera, et cetera. The research has been clear in saying there are ways to go about identifying students that are likely to have challenges, and we need to be starting early to offer these children additional support. Also, providing interventions in small groups. And there were a number of the studies that actually specifically identified group size of 3 to 5 as being ideal. It's important, and research has shown, it's important to differentiate by learner need and to make sure that the learners are actively engaged during the intervention experience. The last piece, and again, this is in the general literature, is there is clear evidence in the need to include systematic progress monitoring. We have to be keeping clear data with good comparative measures. Many programs are using curriculum-based measures, following students' progress, and along with that careful progress monitoring, there must be adaptation and modification to the intervention as warranted. Now, as helpful as those general guidelines are, we still do not know, and one of the meta-analyses, the authors, these are the authors of one of the meta-analyses, and in their conclusion, and I thought this was a great summary statement, students from culturally and linguistically diverse backgrounds may respond differently to these various instructional interventions. And we saw some evidence of that, of a little bit lower effect size when the interventions were being used with English learners. Therefore, careful attention must be paid to whether research has supported various interventions intended to be implemented for specific groups of students. And this takes us back again to where we are now in terms of needing more research. I've come up with three guideposts, and I'm going to have to move quickly because I already see I've only got 10 minutes left. We want to make sure there's plenty of time for discussion. The first guidepost that I have here, that this came again from this most recent review for me of the literature, and the big takeaway was English learners or kids learning through the medium of second language, we cannot just be intervening and looking at intervening with their language, their reading skills only. We have to always be mindful of the fact that these children need systematics and direct support for language development. Keeping our eye on the language development piece is very important. And the second thing that I'll talk briefly about was the finding in a few of these meta-analyses about the importance of what they called multi-componential focus on literacy, which basically means just focusing on one of the big five ideas is not nearly as effective as focusing on two, three, or sometimes even five. I don't know if I'm going to have time to really get into this, but this I thought was a really compelling piece of work by Susan Hopewell and Kathy Escamilla, and they basically are talking about the point that we've had that we've had others address, which is when you're looking at bilingual learners, we can't afford really to only assess them and base decisions about whether or not they have a reading disability when we are assessing them in one language only. They found that when they used with this group of 263 bilingual third graders in transitional bilingual education programs, if they were assessed in English only, 84% of the third graders would have been labeled as at risk and require an independent learning plan. If they were used in Spanish, if they were assessed, excuse me, in Spanish only, Spanish scores only, 55% would have required an independent learning plan. Already a significant reduction just going to their first language. That's the shift. But more interestingly even than that was if they were assessed within both their Spanish language and English language, and their reading levels were being looked at holistically. That means taking into account what they can do both in their first language and in their second language, the percentage of at-risk children in need of an independent learning plan was 40%. That's 44% fewer children than when an English-only measure was used. So they conclude that struggling readers may simply be emerging biliterate students exhibiting a normal biliteracy acquisition trajectory. Which brings us back to that point for the guidepost. Such children really need language development. We need to be thinking about language, not just literacy. This has to do also with language development. Again, large intervention effect sizes were linked to combination of practices, explicit instruction in oral language and listening comprehension, read aloud routine with explicit vocabulary instruction, and scaffolded story retelling, okay? Word study and phonics strategies, vocabulary development and reading comprehension. So again, you see this sort of multi-componential focus. Had larger intervention effect sizes. Intervention effect sizes were also larger in studies that implemented intervention, again, in more than one basic reading component. 60% of the studies that did so had larger effect sizes, and 30% of them did intervention in all, 30% of those with large effect sizes did intervention in all five big ideas or basic skills. The one exception turned out to be vocabulary. I thought that was kind of interesting. What the studies showed was that when it came to vocabulary, that happened to be a skill area that benefited even from an exclusive focus on vocabulary alone. Conclusion, overall interventions that include multiple reading components seem to have the most evidence supporting their effectiveness for phonemic awareness, phonics fluency, and comprehension. Early interventions, the studies showed, can also benefit by focusing on decoding and comprehension. I thought that was interesting because we think about the K-3, those early primary learners, and oftentimes we think about providing intervention in those beginning literacy skills, really often with a focus on the sub-skills of decoding. These studies suggested that the children benefit by a focus not only on decoding, but also comprehension. And then, although we have very few studies in grades 4 through 8, the comprehension interventions for the older ELs, it was demonstrated that they may be more effective when they were accompanied, again, here we're going, by basic skills. So when you're working with the older learners and you're really trying to focus on supporting their comprehension, remember you have to also ensure that they still have those basics. So it's both ways. With the younger, make sure you're focusing on comprehension. With the older, make sure you've got that focus on some of those earlier skills. Again, a statement from the literature. We encourage practitioners to individualize comprehension interventions based on each student's unique needs. That's been a theme, and Fred pointed to that right early on in his introductory slides, the importance of individualizing our interventions. This second point is about tailoring interventions, not only to the learners, because our learners in immersion and dual language programs vary substantially, and these differences need to be taken carefully into account when we are considering what their issues are and how best to help them. We also need to be making sure that we are accounting for differences in languages. All languages do not function the same, so it matters what the 2 or 3 languages or 4 languages that a child is maybe learning. We need to be taking into consideration developmental sequences, the features of specific language impairment in the respective languages, differences in phonetics, morphology. And intervention practice often recommends focusing first on those things. Here's an example of phonemes from bilinguistics.com for Spanish and English, focusing on common phonemes and then moving to a focus on the phonemes and how they differ between the two languages. This last point that I want to make, which is such a big issue in our field, I think, and here's the best practice, current state of the knowledge based on this review of the literature. Bilingual pedagogy, bilingual intervention, right? So if your pedagogy is bilingual and your interventions are monolingual, that's a misstep. If we've heard nothing else at this conference, we've gotten the message clearly that it is when both languages, the higher the levels of bilingualism and the higher the levels of biliteracy, that is where the power is. So if we have children that are struggling with developing language and literacy, the solution is not to begin focusing on monolingual interventions in one language only. Rather, it is to commit ourselves to bilingual intervention. There's a variety of arguments over the years about use stronger language for this, use bilingual intervention here. I definitely encourage you to get your hands on that Thordardottir, a 2010 article. She's in the School of Communication Disorders up at McGill University, and it's a very thoughtful paper taking a look at the importance of using bilingual intervention. This was an interesting study. I'm running out of time here, so I'm going to move through it very quickly, where Spanish home language first graders who were at risk for reading problems participating in a transitional bilingual education program received reading instruction and intervention in Spanish. They were randomly assigned to a treatment and control group where they half of the students received this direct, explicit, systematic bilingual intervention. Those are some of the skills that you see, 3 to 5 students daily, 50 minutes with a bilingual certified teacher. And the other half got sort of business as usual for kids that struggle. There were no differences between these two groups at pretest, but those children who received interventions in Spanish when reading instruction was in Spanish had significant post-test differences in Spanish, including letter sound identification, phonological awareness composite, and you can see the other skills here. Those results are impressive. The discussion, not only did the treatment group students show greater growth in Spanish decoding abilities than comparison students over the course of the year, but they also showed increased growth in comprehension of written Spanish material and higher overall comprehension levels at the end of the intervention period. Again, a study that clearly, at least when it comes to English learners at risk, provides direct support that offering intervention in Spanish is an effective practice. What we know is children from minority home language backgrounds who have difficulties with language and literacy benefit from additional intensive support for their home language development. We cannot be abandoning that home language, and I would argue in the case of our one-way immersion programs, we cannot be abandoning the minority language. Right, that we can't abandon that language and just move to English. The language of intervention, this is another, I think, something I've been arguing and recommending actually for quite some time, but there was some evidence of language of intervention should match with the language of instruction for the given content area. That's, I think, an important takeaway. And finally, bilingual intervention promotes bilingualism and biliteracy. That's what we do. It's one of our core goals. So instead of just talking about intervention practices, let's start talking about bilingual intervention. Thank you.
Okay, we're all going to reassemble, and just, I'm not going to recap anything, you've heard everything, and you can see they're quite different from one another, but it does give you a sense of not only the paucity of work out there, but the different natures of the work that's being done there. So we'll just throw it wide open, either to ask questions of the panelists, or for you to actually contribute to the kinds of information we're trying to disseminate, because you may have some insights and experiences about at-risk learners that would be useful for all of us to hear. Okay. And we have people passing who will pass microphones around.
Thank you. That was a wonderful research presentation, all of them. Thank you. So I have a question. I just started an early childhood Mandarin immersion program, and I accepted a child who is speech delayed. And, you know, the child's doctor said, no, but the child's mother said, I want him, and I said, fine. And so what I want to do, because we're just starting, we're doing our assessment of all the children, and we actually want to begin to collect data on all that we're doing. We take children 18 months to 4 years, and he's 2 years old. And so what I want to do is ask you, what would be some good, data to collect? What would be a good reason? Like, so we're doing an assessment of all the children, and every quarter we'll go back to it. We're using teaching strategies, but we're also going to do a video of each child. Can you give us some suggestions? I would like to.
So the child, is this working? Yeah. So the child's 2 years of age at this point.
Right, and just turned two.
And it's in an early childhood context, which is
Mandarin immersion play-based.
Right. And so it's all Mandarin or?
Well, the Mandarin teachers speak to them 100% of the time. They hear some English from me and others. So okay. We call it 80-20.
Right. Well, with that age group, the kinds of assessment, there are two ways you can do assessment, I think. I could classify it into two. One is you can use observational information from adults who are working with those children. And you could even do, depending on how you want to use the data and how seriously you want to collect data, you could actually do recordings of the child's interactions.
We'd like to, yes.
That would be interesting. I mean, there could be some interesting dissertation work here. But the other way in which people typically collect information on language development in that age group is there are various report measures that you can use that can be completed by parents and or teachers. And they focus on different aspects of language development. But there's like the MacArthur Communicative Development Index. Do you know that? It's very, very widely used. It exists in many languages. I think maybe Chinese, but I'm not sure.
Yes, it does.
And it's a measure that typically parents report. And so in this case, the parents are both English speaking?
Yes.
Okay. So it would be a way of monitoring the child's language development in English. There's two forms, one for younger children, one for older children. And it's normed on illustrates what is typical for children at different age groups. So it would be a way of tracking this child's vocabulary development and also early grammar, because there's two components, a vocabulary subscale and a grammar subscale, based on parents' oral reports. And it sort of would allow you to track this child's language development. Now, I'm assuming if this child is language delayed, is he or she seeing a language specialist?
Yes, they've assigned one. I don't think they've got a quality person. When I say that, you know, the Department of Ed has assigned them a
right
therapist.
But it would make sense to try and get access to those data or somehow or other work with that person, because that person undoubtedly has also got some information.
Right. He's just starting, and the person they sent wasn't so good. So they're in the stages of starting that.
Well, with respect to Chinese, you could look to see if there's a Chinese version of the MacArthur, and it seems to me what you might have to do in that situation is have the teachers complete it, because in fact this child's use of Chinese is restricted to the playgroup. Is that right? It's not quite sure how you would interpret those scores, though, because they would be normed on typically developing Chinese-speaking children. But those are the kinds of measures that people typically use, either spontaneous language samples from the child or reports of what the child is doing in language. But there's also other measures with respect to the child's behavior, child behavioral checklist and so forth and so on. So there are things out there that you can, I would actually Google and say, language assessment in toddlers, and see what comes up. Or go to reports like Journal of Child Language, journals that actually report on language development in children, and look at the kinds of measures, or speak to somebody at the university wherever you're living. There are measures that people use, because this is an age group when people are intensely interested in, although it's hard to find measures that are appropriate for second language assessment.
Yeah, I haven't found any. In fact, I thought there weren't any. That's why we're using teaching strategies and making up our own.
You can use the monolingual ones, but you just have to be mindful that you're using them, not using them as monolingual norms. You can't. And it's not clear how you would interpret them, except to monitor that there's change.
Right.
It's a bit tricky, because this is a Chinese second language speaker at a young age. You can't compare him to native speakers, and there's no normative data on
that. Well, I can compare him to the other children in the
Yes, that's right.
Nursery school.
And it might be a useful data set to have for the school. That's my suggestion. Does anybody else want to suggest any other methods? But that's how people typically, we've looked at children in this age group, and it's often recordings that we do, and then it's very labor intensive. You have to transcribe and then analyze it, or you use various kinds of oral report measures, checklists and things.
Okay, thank you very
much. And there are quite a few, but they're not designed for that learner group. That's the dilemma.
Could I email you?
Sure.
Thank you. Okay, great, thanks.
Let me just say, maybe I'll just weigh in just a little bit. One on, again, this handout, grab a copy. The Simon Cerejido and Gutierrez Clerin study from 2014 actually was carried out in a preschool setting, Head Start preschool setting. It's not the same languages, it's Spanish-English. But the reason I think it might be of interest is you can take a look at some of the measures, assessment measures, ways they went about assessing the children's early, young children's language. These were three-year-olds, so not that far away. Oftentimes people use the Peabody
picture vocabulary test,
yes. So, or coming up with a measure of vocabulary size, having a way to kind of see how their word knowledge is growing. They will also invite children and record children as they are trying to tell a wordless picture story. Right? So various ways of, again, like Fred was saying, getting language samples. The last thing that I would say is, we know that language delay is often very related to exposure and production opportunities of an individual child. So I always encourage people to really be thinking and asking a lot of questions about exposure and production right. opportunities for that child. Yes, but how much contact time they have with the child, how much time the child has been in child, language development is very complex. And one of the things that I think we don't do well enough is start by making sure that we're asking enough questions so that we really have a better picture of what's going on. Secondly, making sure that the auditory mechanisms are in place for that child. Many young children that experience language delay have hearing issues that have not really been right, identified yet.
Yeah.
And so some of these basic things are really worth keeping in mind before we go into assessment mania.
The other reference I would give you is we wrote a book called Dual Language Development and Disorders. It's Parity, Genesee, and Crago. And it may give you more than you want, but it is a summary of research on young dual language learners and what's typical development and what's atypical. But this is an unusual situation. But it'll give you an idea of some of the measures that are used. But I would reinforce Tara. Look at auditory issues. Is the child's hearing normal? Has the child experienced repeated bouts of otitis media, things like that, because that can interfere with like otitis media, earaches,
ear infections. One last thing. Here's the other thing that we know is that when it comes to Mandarin, developing oral language in Mandarin, oftentimes we associate Mandarin with an impossibly difficult to learn language, right? So why would we, perhaps being in a Mandarin daycare or preschool context might be more damaging because of the difficulty of the language. When it comes to verbal, oral and listening skills, Mandarin is evidencing itself to be just as easily acquired as languages such as Spanish and German. So Mandarin in and of itself should not sound off alarms at this age.
Yes, question in the back.
Thank you very much. I have a question. Is there any knowledge about cross effects or interdependencies between multiple disadvantaged children? For instance, just to give you examples, children that are foreign language, English language learners, but also are delayed in their language production, also in their first language. Or another example, we had one student in the autism spectrum trying to learn Chinese, could not produce a tonal language in combination with fine motor skills delays. So is there any threshold where it is just getting too much, or also children that already learn two languages back at home or speak two languages back at home come into a language environment at school learning the third language? Is there any knowledge if, multiplying all those different disadvantages?
I'm not sure what you're asking, actually. Is it just me, or?
Yeah. Well, Well, just the last thing that you were asking, do we know anything about, you know, if the children are third language learners, if they're learning three languages, for example? Third language learners are also children that have been they are able to be successful also in an immersion in a dual language context. So it has more to do with the nature of support that they're being offered. I think you're trying to see is there a tipping point when all of a sudden being in a dual language and immersion program really is not a good idea.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
That's what I think I'm hearing you ask. And the answer to that, I think, is really no. You know, we don't really, there isn't third language children, so children coming in with three languages, again, given appropriate and sufficient individualized support in a community of learners, they're likely to do as well in the languages of support as they would if they were in a one language program, right? That is our consistent finding. And what we've really heard from this conference is the value of bilingualism and biliteracy in terms of cognitive skills. So my response to that question of, you know, is there a tipping point is, I have not yet read a study that has identified the tipping point.
Well, what I would add is that I would agree in general that so far it's the empirical side of thing is an issue of half full or half empty. Because the evidence is so sparse. And so far, there's no evidence to suggest that dual language learning is difficult for either typically developing or atypically developing children. Now, that could change, actually, as we get more research and more fine-tuned research and so on. But so far, in my opinion, there's no evidence that would justify, certainly at a policy level, excluding children from dual language programs because they're suspected of having certain kinds of impairment, nor should these children be, their parents be discouraged from raising them bilingually. Now, having said that, here's all the caveats. There's a lot of research on children with impairments, and we just don't have that research. I mean, there's a lot, so children who are deaf, for example, children who might have severe attention deficit. I haven't seen research on ADHD. So what we know is all saying the same thing, but we haven't looked at all at-risk groups. And what we have done within the groups we've looked at have looked at really bilingual kids. There's very little on trilingual children, and we know that even in the case of bilingual children, while early learners are very effective dual language learners, they're not so good that you can throw any number of languages at them at the same time. They need a certain amount of exposure to each one to be functioning at a reasonably high level. So for studies by Thordedotter, for example, and there's not a lot of this research, but people are arguing that, you know, 30-40% of exposure is often enough to give you performance that's typical for monolinguals. What that says to us is that if you've got families that are talking about trilingualism or quadrilingualism, in my opinion, the parent shouldn't expect that the child could achieve equally high levels in all languages. I would be interested to hear what other people say. I always tell parents, because that's the situation in many families. I mean, these parents call me up and the father speaks Arabic and the mother speaks Spanish and they live in Quebec, so the child has to go to French daycare, but they want to learn English, so they want it. Should I hire a nanny who speaks English? So, and I caution them. But I also say, you know, you might want to do that, but you might want to prioritize which of these two languages you want the child to be not orally but also literate in. Which of the languages would you be happy for the child to be functionally competent in social, that kind of thing. There are trade-offs, and I think it's really about the learning environment, but it's also about, at some point, children need a certain amount of input for the system to really fully decode the system. So we have to be careful because as much as I'm enthusiastic and I tend to say that there's no reason not to include these children, we also have to acknowledge as professionals the research base is narrow and it's not very deep.
I agree with that.
Okay. I have a question about, this is not necessarily about kids who have been identified with special needs, but kids who are in an one-way immersion program who tend to act out behaviorally when the second language is being used in the classroom. and they are fine and pay attention and are great when they are in English, don't appear to have a learning disability in English, are learning fairly normally, but the use of the second language. And these are kids who are anywhere from kindergarten through fourth or fifth grade.
I know some adults like that.
Who just, so I guess my question would be, is there research about that, that for some kids just learning that second language is very, very difficult and impossible, or, you know, that's not necessarily a special need as we're defining it with special education. Mm-hmm. And then the other piece of that is I'm also noticing, at least in my school, an urban school, one-way Spanish immersion, we're seeing more and more kids with mental health needs across the board coming from trauma. And those are some of the kids who tend to have a harder time with the Spanish. And I'm wondering if they're just trying to cope with so many things that the addition of a language that is not their first language is just too much. And I am very reluctant to ever say that immersion is not for all kids. We don't necessarily counsel them out, but they get taken out by their parents who say, this is just too hard, we're going to take them out. So I don't know what the question is all in all of that, but help is, I guess, my question.
Well, let me try to deal with the first question in terms of children acting out in immersion or dual language programs, because we have seen that. And one thing we notice is that sometimes children are acting out because they don't want to be in the program. And it's not because the language is too hard. It's because there are things going on at home, and they see this as a power issue. And it's the only way they have of dealing with power issues with their parents. There's other stuff going on in the home. Sometimes there's divorce. Sometimes there's other kinds of trauma going on. And so the children act out and it looks as if they are acting out because they don't want to be in the program. And they might not want to be in the program, but sometimes it's not. It doesn't have anything to do with language. It has to do with what's going on in the home environment, which gets back to, I think, the second issue, which is about mental health issues. And what we know from the research is that there are very few studies, but there are a couple of recent studies that do seem to suggest that children who are bicultural and biliterate and bilingual have the best mental health outcomes. And, you know, that makes a lot of sense if, you know, we really look at some of the mental health research and we look at some issues of, you know, how children develop a sense of self, you know, when they're growing up within two cultures, or sometimes three cultures. I do think that children who are coming in, immigrating, or who are having other kinds of trauma, and that would include child abuse and other kinds of traumas that we don't really deal with sometimes effectively in the classroom environment, that those children may have different kinds of experiences. And it might be that another language is more challenging than they can deal with attentionally. But that's not to say that, you know, children can't deal with two languages effectively. But I think when there are additional mental health issues, the mental health issues can have a negative impact on the attention that they can give to, that the attention they have to give to learning and kind of maintaining a healthy kind of achievement and learning pattern in the classroom. Can be negatively affected by, you know, other kinds of issues that they can't control. And so that's my take on it, but others may want to.
I guess one of the things that I would say is that, you know, with issues related to anxiety, first I'll go back and say there actually has been some research. It's not an experimental kind of study, but there has been research that has shown that there sometimes that which will end up having a child leave the program end up having to be behavioral kinds of issues. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I remember that Margie wrote actually in the Struggling Learners book, she wrote about difficulty with transitions, right? That maps on to other kinds of children that have really a difficulty making transitions or serious behavior issues, that it is oftentimes those issues that end up having the group come together and deciding perhaps this isn't the best match. So we have, that has been written about in the past. The other thing that I will say, however, I'm going to make another statement just about this anxiety piece, and this is that we are seeing more issues related to anxiety and figuring out how to support that. And it may be that the unfamiliarity, right, and the newness of, I don't know what you're saying, this is making me even more anxious than I already am. That sort of makes intuitive sense. But what we also know is that at the end of the day, it's all about relationship building, right? What is also very, very true is if you follow learners from one teacher group to another, or even just a teacher to a teacher, we see differences oftentimes. And it has to do with that teacher's ability to really establish a relationship with that child such that they are really able to provide that child the level of support emotionally and otherwise that that child can kind of get over some of those other, what might be initial initial challenges, I guess. And so I would just say I would keep that in mind, really be thinking about how is that relationship being nurtured for that child among various teachers and peers in the school environment.
The other bit, I would agree with that. One of the early studies by Maggie Brock on why children switch out of immersion in Canada, it was a very clever study. She looked at kids who were struggling in an immersion program in grades 3 and 4, and at the end of the year, some of those students left the program and some stayed in. And she did a very interesting retrospective analysis to see, well, what differentiated these kids who stayed in and those who left. And she found that the kids who left and the kids who stayed in, who were struggling when she went into the school, were equally challenged academically. So it wasn't that the kids who left were challenged more academically. They were both challenged academically. What did distinguish the kids who left were behavioral issues. The kids who finally they decided to move were acting out. And they were acting out not only in the French immersion part, they were acting out in the English stream as well. So what apparently the process was that it was the behavioral problems that the kids were posing that finally compelled the parents to make the decision to move the children. But it turned out that when they moved the children, it took some time for these behavioral problems to sort themselves out anyway. But I want to reinforce what a point Tara made during her presentation is that, and you're probably doing this, but it's really critically important to get a really, really, really thorough background information on these children, especially if you're talking about third and fourth language children and children who are recent to the school. Because one of the things I've seen is that especially, you know, even in international schools, and these are very highly privileged children, these children's language histories are dramatic. They're often multilingual, and I sometimes worry that they're really not getting enough of anything to really master them. And I think children can be traumatized by too many languages too soon. But I also think that the other point I want to make is that whether or not you even go down these routes should depend on how important is the other language. The advice I give parents is if they're living in a bilingual community or bilingual family, it's worth going down this route. But if you're at the middle of the country in a monolingual English-speaking, you know, area, then you really want to be very careful about going down this route because you probably can make it work, but the issue is it worth it? Because it's going to be work for your child, for you, for the school system, and what's the point? So sometimes you get parents that are like that. They're so adamant about getting their child bilingual, they'll do it at any cost. And I don't agree with that. I think just because children can do it doesn't mean it's a good idea.
My quick follow-up question is, would you consider non-standard English another language? Mm. Many of our students are African-American.
Would you consider non-standard English another language? And for the, but it's interesting, in immersion schools, there's very little research on African-American children, in Spanish in particular, so there isn't even a good database. But the children that we have, again, are as successful as they would be, and I think more successful, just because they get so much attention from us. That's an ongoing thing, whether it's a second language. But I just wanted to throw out from what you'd said before, is I have told my staff, and we stick to, we never counsel anyone to leave. So it's our job, we're public school, to take the children that come, and even though they come to us from 8 neighborhoods, and the teachers often say, send them back. We can't. As soon as we accept them, they're ours. And yes, if we're calling the parents daily, often they just feel that if they pull their children, that it'll be calmer and easier somewhere else, which is not necessarily the case. And that's only anecdotal over 22 years of having the parents of the children who were pulled come back and say, no, we're just having the same difficulties. And we've gotten to know that new principal just as well as we know you.
I will just add to that, because you're asking about the African American population, and I have been working with Prince George's County with very high percentage of African American children, but most recently with Baltimore International Academy. In the heart of Baltimore, there is now a one-way immersion program. They're doing immersion in 5 different languages, and the vast majority of children are students in the program, and it's a K-8. Public school, IB charter, are African American. These children are learning Spanish, Chinese, Arabic, Russian, and French, not all at the same time. They're in one of those 5 programs, okay, it's not simultaneous, but they're in one of those 5 programs. And the programs to date, the program's about 10 years old now, they're having success with this African American urban population in the heart of Baltimore City. So do I think that having an African-American vernacular would preclude success in an immersion environment? My answer to that would be, we don't have any data to date that would suggest that that would be true, and we do have at least anecdotal evidence that these students from African-American urban background are in fact being successful in the immersion context.
We have some data, it's very old at this point, from a school that Mimi met it was in the Cincinnati area, and this was a French-English and Spanish-English immersion program, and some of these children were from the Appalachian area, and arguably, we're also speaking a non-standard dialect of English, which would not be unsimilar to African-American dialect. So they were really learning 3 languages. They were standard American English and either French and Spanish. And when we looked at the data, the children in the bilingual program were doing just as well as the comparable children in the regular program. There's no reason to think it should be a problem a priori, and there's no evidence to say that it is a problem, but we don't have evidence in it to say that it's actually a huge success. But
I wasn't thinking necessarily that they couldn't be successful, but I'm also thinking I've never considered it as a third language, mm-hmm. and maybe we need to start considering that mm-hmm. in our instructions, especially if they're structured.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Hi. We are. For Dr. Fortune, we were nodding the whole entire time. So we have a more practical question. How do we convince the school district that in a school district that has 7 bilingual strands to provide help for the students with special needs, help in the language of instruction as opposed to help in English? And maybe Dr. Myers would have something to say as a principal. How do you convince your school district to find personnel that would help counter this issue?
And then even more specifically, how do you set it up? How do you schedule it? How do you fund it? Who provides the intervention? What materials are used?
And we have 4 minutes left.
Every summer of my life is what I do with that.
No, in fact, when you mention all the languages being taught, that's the first thing that comes to mind is how difficult it is to staff. I took a trip with other principals to Beijing, and we were talking about immersion and how they could help us bring in Mandarin speakers to the United States, and what they were doing with the schools that were offering Mandarin programs was sending one teacher to a school for not even the entire school year. And I made the mistake, I'm not good with Chinese culture, that I decided to answer the question, and I was kicked under the table because apparently can't answer the question. I said, you know, for me, you'd have to send 15 teachers, send them for 3 solid years, send them for, you know, to really get at it. So hiring special ed teachers with all of the language, let me back up. In my district, it's an English-only state. There is no, there isn't even a bilingual certification for teachers. I'm the one that decides if they're bilingual enough to work at Key School. And so I just can't imagine how you would have enough funding to have a special ed teacher for six. I have 720 kids, almost 12% special ed, and with that, it gets me maybe 4.5 teachers, special ed teachers. So I don't even, I mean, logistically, I don't know how you could get one for each language. So that would present its own problem. Colleagues of mine who just have the one language find it difficult. I just won't take no for an answer on that, that you have to speak Spanish and be certified as a special ed teacher to work at Key, and it's hard. Sometimes I go without. So to have 5 languages or whatever you have, I'm sorry, I don't. There's no easy answer. And I'm sure the school system is not going to give you someone full-time if they're, you know, they could run one person in other schools. But that would be quite a challenge with both the situations in Baltimore and PG County and what you're doing. I just financially, I can't imagine a school district saying yes. And schedules, I'll be glad to talk to you later.
I don't know, we probably only have room for 2 or 3. The fellow in the back, have you had your hand up for a while?
I can't see anybody back there.
I'll be really quick. Similar to the principal over there, we have a student, I think, that probably really doesn't like Chinese in our Chinese immersion. His English scores are through the roof, and he's in 6th grade. We've been doing Chinese intervention for years. Would you still, and I know we have to work with the parent, and that's a political thing, but would you still give intervention then in both languages with a spread that wide, you know, based on some of the things you shared earlier?
But does he have any kind a learning disability? Or he just doesn't like the language and he's not performing well? Because
I think that's part of it.
I actually personally think that that's one of the reasons why kids should be moved, because it's a personality issue. And if a child doesn't like the program and if it's not important for the child's development, what's the point, in my opinion? Because there are children who go in, and for a variety of personal reasons, they don't like it. They don't like the frustration. My feeling is
that next door is not doing it.
Yeah, I say allow the child to get what he or she wants. What's the point?
Will you tell that to the parent for me?
Well, that's the point. Yes.
And that's the difficult piece. So
I understand.
As a principal, I've carefully had that conversation with the parent, and she gets very mad at me.
Well, tell them Fred Genesee told you.
Okay.
And he's going back to Canada.
Okay, but your question was, if the child stays in the program, would you be still offering intervention in both languages? And the answer to that question, I think, my answer to that question would be yes. I would still want to offer support in both languages. Actually, it sounds like the child doesn't need support in English.
English, no.
So, but are you asking, would you continue to offer support in Mandarin?
What's the support, though? He doesn't have an impairment. He has an attitude problem.
Well, but you said he's fallen quite behind in Mandarin. He's 3 years behind in Mandarin. So if you're asking me, you know, would I continue to offer support for Mandarin if he stays in the Mandarin immersion program, then I wouldn't say, no, we're not going to stop. So good, the gap will become even greater and you're going to hate the experiences even more. I would offer support and try and see if there's some really fun, creative ways that you might be able to do that, something that might jumpstart his interest and passion for learning the language.
No, seriously.
I have a question related to that.
Sure.
I have a question related to that, and I'm sorry, is it wrapped up?
No, go ahead. When does the closing session, 3 minutes? It starts at 4:15.
Okay.
Sure, go ahead.
Well, just so maybe a way to prevent something like that. So what I see at my school is every year we have, we're a two-way immersion, 90-10 Spanish school. And every year we have a handful of kids who struggle mightily to develop literacy skills in the target language of Spanish. And these are English-dominant kids. And then we, in third grade, when we start doing more formal English literacy instruction, they do just fine in English most of the time. So my question is, would it be beneficial for those kids to provide intervention in their dominant language earlier and maybe provide more of a bridge into the second language from an earlier time?
Okay, we don't have research that answers that question. It's a great question. But what I, you know, what I go back to, Josh, is your program, the goals of the program, right, are academic achievement, bilingualism and biliteracy, right? And you have a 90-10 model. Instruction for literacy is happening in Spanish in those early years. Then is the answer at that point to introduce English? I would say no, and for a few different reasons. Now, one of them is that orthographically, it's actually easier to learn to read in Spanish than it is to read in English. Okay, so that if that the reading experience, the experience of learning how to decode, that actually is an experience that can help facilitate and transfer to good decoding skills in English. So that's one reason to continue with the Spanish intervention. But the other thing is, if we think about the goals of the program and the need to support the bilingualism and the biliteracy, I don't ever see how the answer to that question is to take away support for that minority language prematurely. And that's how I would weigh in on that.
Yeah, it's very hard once you go down that English route to back up and go down the Spanish one. We notice even in our program, they get a 100% French, and they're fine. This is what school's about. They've never been to school. They don't know that they should be doing it in English. But then when English comes into the curriculum, you do notice this sort of, there's these lights going off, like, this is really hard. But and they didn't, I mean, I'm being a bit silly about it, but I think that it is psychologically hard to go down this route of English for an English-dominant child and think you're going to then back up into Spanish. It's hard to do. So with that, I think we probably need to end. Well, thank you very much for your interest and patience.